you should give, expect, and receive. Take what you could, give what you must, cause whatever's for us, for us. Whatever's for us, for us.
Let's see. The forum's purpose is to give a voice to the many issues women face as they work to improve their lives, their families' lives, and their communities' lives. I know, as Adrienne Rich says, that each of the women who are attending as speakers and each of the participants holds a piece of my truth. My truth is incomplete until I have heard and learned their truths and your truths. Sexism teaches a lie that women cannot trust our intelligence, our passion, and our strength. Society teaches that we are incapable of acting. It teaches us to wait for someone else to do the leading. The women sitting on this panel are women who no longer wait. They have seen problems, assessed strategies, and acted decisively and creatively. They are women from Central Texas. They are the leaders that we have been waiting for. We are indeed the leaders we have been waiting for. The two panels will be run in the form of a mono reading. Each speaker will introduce themselves, their organizational affiliation if they wish, and will read their presentations. There will be no break in between speakers. After the first panel of speakers is finished, the second panel will be seated and proceed the same way. At the end of it, it looks very much like a thread that's been woven by many different people, and it is poetry. That's why I wanted to do it this way. It's very exciting.
I'm with the Foundation for a Compassionate Society, and I lived in Italy for about 20 years and came back in 1983 to the United States to do my political duty here. When I was in Italy, I got an international perspective. There were newspapers from many different points of view. Italy at the time had the largest communist party outside of China and Russia, and it also is the headquarters of the Catholic Church. So there was a whole spectrum of political points of view there, and as Rome is the place that all roads lead to, people from all over the world were there as well. It's a very international place. And I was in Italy during the Vietnam War and really felt the strong feeling of people internationally about how much they were against the Vietnam War. And so I got an international perspective, which made me see that our country was responsible for a lot of wrongdoing in the rest of the world. There was a lot of really bad things going on that our country had a lot to do with. So when I came back here, I came back convinced that I should do my political duty to make things better, not only inside our country, but for other people as well. And as I had become a feminist in Italy, and so I really believed then and still do that feminism is the way to go to make those social changes, that feminism is really wider than Marxism because there are more women than there are industrial proletarians. And I don't think that feminism has been taken as a political philosophy as much as it needs to be. And in fact, in this country, after living here for many years and trying to create this foundation and act according to what I consider to be women's values or feminist values, I find that really the definition of reality that takes place here really excludes an alternative point of view, and that people are very much influenced by what comes through the newspapers, on television, and so forth, so that we really don't get a lot of information here that would allow our other alternative point of view to come forward. And what we do in this country is often we blame individuals for the problems that exist instead of blaming the system. When I was in Italy, I learned to look at things systemically And I think that we are here, we have a system which we could call like patriarchal capitalism, something like that. And I think that we can, as feminists and as women, learn to find within ourselves the values that are alternative to that. In fact, I think that system, which is creating, in spite of its own definition of itself, it's creating really a lot of devastation for people all over the earth through the so-called free market system, which is a system which is meant, the word free in there is really a misnomer, because it's free for people to exploit other people is really what the way that works. And I think that we have these misdefinitions and misnomers, and we as women and as feminists who do not believe in a system where you have some people that are dominant and other people that have to be submissive, whether it's on a worldwide scale or an individual scale, we do not believe in that. We have to be able to find alternatives and turn that around. And so I went to Nairobi, the Women's Conference in Nairobi in 1985, and the recent Women's Conference in 1995 in Beijing. And there I found that the women really do have this alternative perspective. There were 40,000 women there in the city of Wairo, and women from all different countries and from different classes, races, religions, and so forth. And there was a great deal of commonality among them of women trying to create a different world. And looking at the subject of this panel, which is the challenges facing us locally, I think that the challenge that faces us most is to put us in the context locally, in the context of this wider international women's movement, because unfortunately our media and our government does not allow us to see that and to know where we stand.
Hello. Hello. My name is Mary Ellen Curtin. I teach history at Southwest Texas State University. And I'd like to begin with an observation about popular images of women in America today. Let's begin with the movies, particularly the nominees for Best Actress Award, undoubtedly the most coveted and well-known of all film awards in the nation. The nominees were Elizabeth Shue in Leaving Las Vegas for her portrayal as a prostitute, Sharon Stone in Casino for her portrayal as a prostitute, Mira Scorvino in Mighty Aphrodite for her portrayal as a prostitute, and Susan Sarandon in Dead Man Walking for her portrayal as a nun. I think there's another prostitute movie in there somewhere, but if anyone remembers it, let me know. Three prostitutes and a nun. And of course, no women of color anywhere to be seen. The other popular film this year was Sense and Sensibility. Now, I applaud Emma Thompson and her efforts to bring this Jane Austen classic to the screen, and it was terrific to have a film in which the central characters were women, where the thought, perceptions, and feelings of women were treated as if they mattered, and a portrayal of sisterly devotion. And yet, I think we need to ask, why did this film resonate so? Was it only because it was a poignant love story? I think not. I think it, quote unquote, spoke to a certain audience, as they say, because for so many women still, the decision of marriage is the all-important decision of their lives. Who they marry determines their social position, their economic status, and their future. Young girls are still brought up believing in Prince Charming and men taking care of them, when the reality is something quite different. The reality is that women must be able to take care of themselves economically and their children. But where are the movies about these issues? The persistence and dominance of the Madonna whore imagery in our popular movie culture, coupled with the myth of Prince Charming, speaks volumes about the inability of TV and movies to speak to us about the realities of women's lives and concerns. I have great ideas for movie and TV plots. Here's one that's full of drama, sex, political intrigue, ideas, winners and losers. It's called Graduate School and Looking for a Job. Every semester in my job as a professor at Southwest Texas State University, I meet amazing women. Women in their early 20s with three or more children who are going to school full time. Women graduate students struggling to support children and hang on to their dream of getting a PhD. Freshman women, young women with all A's who say they want to teach kindergarten. And when I say that sounds great, but don't you think you'd be a little bored with that after a while? Have you thought about graduate school? And their eyes absolutely pop out of their head. African-American women who struggle with issues of feminism, womenism, and the political demands facing their own community. All of these would be great topics for movies. Have you thought of, here's another great idea. It's about a black woman in Mississippi in the 60s. She works with her husband, a courageous civil rights activist, he is then murdered in cold blood, shot in the back by a white supremacist. She raises three children, educates them about black people all over the world, moves to Los Angeles, becomes a successful businesswoman, and in the 90s is called to become executive director of the NAACP, healing wounds caused by political division and sexual harassment. It's called the Merle Evers story, and it's true. How about a film about that? My point, and I do have one, okay, is that as an educator, it is my job to introduce feminism to all of my students, male and female, but especially female, because they need feminism to make sense of the world around them and of their own lives. What else is going to explain the lack of real-life stories in movies, the sexual double standard that still rages, the lack of economic-ish options, the struggle of women with children, and how to see the possibilities open to them, even though they may not have those role models in their lives? Another thing I want to talk about is mental health in women. In Bell Hooks's collection of essays called Killing Rage, and this is an excellent collection of all of excerpts from her other books. She's written about 8 collections of essays, but this is the most recent, and it's an excellent survey. She talks about the emotional and psychological costs black women pay for being black and female in this society. And an essay called Healing Our Wounds, Liberatory Mental Health Care, she states, currently, conventional mental health professionals who attend to the needs of black folks often reject any analysis that takes into account a political understanding of our personal pain. This may be true of black mental health care workers as well as everyone else. While there is a growing body of self-help literature that is addressed specifically to black folks, it does not connect political injustice with psychological pain. For example, even though there are many self-help books for black folks that look at the issue of low self-esteem expressed in extreme self-hatred, sometimes overtly relating it to internalized racisms, such works rarely talk about healing processes that would include radical politicization and social activism. When I wrote Sisters of the Yam, another Bell Hooks book, the intent was to highlight the connections among psychological trauma, mental disorders, and the madness of forming self and identity in white supremacist capitalist patriarchy. While I wanted to emphasize the importance of individual work for self-recovery, I also wanted to link that work to progressive action for political change. And then she continues, until progressive black critical thinkers, especially those who specialize in mental health care, distinguish between habits of survival used to withstand racist assault that are no longer useful and constructive, there can be no collective development of resistance strategies that outline concrete ways to create healthy minds. By not addressing our psychological wounds, by covering them, we create the breeding ground for pervasive learned helplessness and powerlessness. This lack of agency nurtures compulsive addictive behavior and promotes addiction. Rarely do discussions of drug, alcohol, and food addiction and black life link these problems to any desire to escape from psychological pain that is the direct result of racist assault and/or our inability to cope effectively with that assault. Yet, if this is reality is not considered, then the root causes of genocidal addiction may remain unaddressed. I think Hooks's words need to be thought about by everyone in our society who bears the weight of maintaining the capitalist, racist, patriarchal system. Poverty, racism, sexism all hurt. They all have immense psychological consequences that can potentially lead to self-destructive behavior. We in the feminist community must promote mental health care among the poor, among those who most need it but can least afford it. Now, there is a bill currently being debated in the House that will require some employers to offer mental health insurance on parity with other health insurance needs. This would be a breakthrough, but there's a distinct possibility that this bill will not pass, and I think that this issue has to be on the feminist agenda. Finally, I'd like to recall a story Jesse Jackson told in 1984 when he was running for president. You remember the race, Michael Dukakis, the Rainbow Coalition, Gary Hart running around talking about new ideas. Well, Jesse Jackson made a habit during the campaign of staying with ordinary people, often poor people, wherever he went. And one time, in response to a particularly stupid question from the press, he responded by saying, "Look, the people I stayed with last night have plenty of ideas. They don't need any new ideas," as Gary Hart said. "What they need is money." Economic struggle is the reality of many women's lives in America today. It is women who constitute the majority of the poor, and it is they who are bearing the brunt of brutal conservatism and slashing social services offered by the Republicans and, dare I say, the cringing Democrats. And as for family values, well, I must say, although I appreciate the topic that has brought us all here together today, personally, I think it is a most unfortunate term that feminists and thinking people should not use. Why? Because it is a slogan. Nothing more and nothing less, to disguise reactionary and discriminatory policies against the poor, gay and lesbians, free thinkers, individuals, and anyone else who did not go along with the moral majority. To think that it can be co-opted, I believe, is foolish. I also think that people cannot ignore the fact that for centuries, family values, buttressed by the law, economics, and society, worked against the freedom of women. Family values and free women were a contradiction in terms, because the maintenance of family, as it was defined in many places and not everywhere, demanded the subordination of women. That was a fact, but now that is changing. Now we have families where women and men share economic burdens. Now, this has often been the case with the poor, but also, and I feel that this is the real change, the domestic burden of raising children. Now we have families where fathers are parenting and doing domestic work, and this is a great change. Now we have families that don't necessarily force women to choose between their dreams and their responsibilities. And we have single parents fighting for respect and honor as they struggle to raise children in a hostile society. These are families too. But I think that women have to fight for recognition and support of their lives and struggles by acknowledging and insisting upon the superiority of these changes over the old. We don't need a slogan. We need action and we need ideas. Thank you.
Hello. My name is Anna Cisnet, and I'm a poet, I'm an immigrant, and I'm a parent of a son and daughter. I am currently on the staff of the Foundation for a Compassionate Society. I'm also known as Technomama, which is a foundation project, has conducted numerous training sessions in various countries and here locally for women, for low-income communities, for people of color, and progressive organizations led by women. Our work has taken us to Europe, to Asia, Latin America, around the U.S. and the state of Texas. I must say that given everything from ignorance and lack of sensitivity and widespread deliberate attempts to discredit women in general, feminism and feminists in particular, it is amazing that we can gather here to develop and work on strategies to implement a reflection of feminist perspectives. Lest it be forgotten, the world is much greater than the boundaries of the United States. And all my comments have been informed by and are meant to be inclusive of women around the world who have been crossing borders for generations to meet with each other and to effect positive, progressive change long before jets, computers, and television. We can do domestic work and other forms of work that includes all kinds of machines, but when it comes to those that would add to our power as a category, the doors are slammed in our faces. Among the challenges to feminism that I've been most sensitive to as I do the work is that of access to media. And that's the machine, those are the machines in a way that I'm referring to. and I'm including training, funding, equipment, extensive and inclusive policies, studies, decision-making, freedom of speech and expression, and structures for implementation of those policies, legislation, and strategies that are sensitive to the needs of and to the needs and interests of women and girls. Of course, if we don't know how to access that information and those resources in the first place, it's all useless. And so literacy, including all spoken, signed, and written languages, is critical. It is also critical that we look at the way in which the creation of the infrastructures needed to provide media resources be ecologically sound, that labor conditions assure physical and emotional health for its workers. It is critical that for feminism to be better understood, we must continue to learn to reflect, respect, and articulate our own lives and the lives of women everywhere, including those who may not necessarily self-identify as feminists, but who may be living their lives perhaps more closely to a feminist ideal than many who own the term and claim the term as an exclusive badge. While the work I do currently focuses on demystifying the internet and advocating for greater inclusion of people who are traditionally left out of the circles of power and knowledge, I am well aware that that form of communication may not be considered appropriate by and for everyone, but it is up to communities to determine what is appropriate for them. And in order to do that, they also need to know what it is they're choosing to accept or not. We as women work with innumerable forms of technology, from beer and cheese making machines to highly developed technologies. Our work has led us to remind women that they need not be embarrassed if they don't know how to work a machine. How many of us remember putting fax paper in backwards the first time, or who hung up when an answering machine picked up our call for the very first time? We advocate for a multifaceted approach that includes radio, television, cable access, fax networks, print media, video, and computer networking, among others, and any other form acceptable, developed by, promoted by communities from which they arise, in order to promote collaboration, communication, information sharing, and gathering. And we advocate for media women themselves to make room in their work, in the field of media work, to include themselves in all facets of organizing and advocacy. All too often, we're busy covering events and presenting events, but we don't do the work of lobbying and advocacy on the behalf of more greater access to media by women. I do feel very strongly that it is up to those of us I urge all of us to notice and to remember that while we drag our feet on these issues, while we work to understand it, while we ponder over what all this is about, the right wing around the world and fundamentalist forces have been extremely efficient at using all kinds of media to promote itself and its agenda. I do feel very strongly that it is up to those of us with information at least to share it. And I advocate that we put aside our resistance to and fear of the new and different long enough to learn about the ways in which these technologies affect our lives in order to better counter the dangerous effects of them on our lives. Whether we know it or not, like it or not, daily we are surrounded by computers that don't always work in our best interest. Why then not learn what this technology is about and how it works so we can best defend ourselves against it? Use it to our own advantage where possible. Why not appropriate media for our best interests and those of our communities? Why not have our own media, our own C-SPAN, our own CNN, our own radio stations to cover the institutions that are daily making decisions that affect our lives without our knowledge and without our participation? It is not far-fetched, in my opinion, and given what I've seen around the world, when you consider the collective power of women. Thank you.
My name is Dottie Curry, and I'm manager of community outreach for Planned Parenthood, and a volunteer with the Foundation for Compassionate Society. I'd like to take every opportunity to thank Genevieve Vaughn for the hard work that she's done, and I don't think I would be here doing what I'm doing if it weren't for her. When I was younger, I didn't know about feminism. I didn't have a definition for feminism. I had a great dislike for injustice. And some people are born poets, some people are born writers, some people are born painters, and I seem to have been born into activism. It's like, this is not going well, this is not right, and something needs to be done about it. So from 4 years old, I remember standing up in school and church and all those places, just regular neighborhood places, fighting for the rights of disabled people, disadvantaged people, and for myself, including myself as a woman, myself as a black person. And down through the years, it's been hard to separate my activism. Am I fighting for rights of black people? Am I fighting for rights of women, of the disabled, you know, mental health rights? And I think I've decided it's not necessary. I think I fight for human rights and across the board. originally, I didn't know that what I was doing was feminism or that what I was doing was activism. And then all of a sudden there was Gloria Steinem and there was Angela Davis and there were people who were putting words to my suffering and my pain, my struggle, and also my hopes and my dreams. And that was a great comfort to me. They didn't know who I was, but I was there listening to them going, I'm not here alone. And then as I grew older, I found that there were people right alongside me that were thinking the way I was thinking. And then I got even older, and there were people who were actively fighting for those rights, the Genevieve and Anna Cisnet and Sharon Bridgeforth, the many other people that I could name. Right now, I'm a member of a group, and an elders group in Austin, and I think there are about 8 or 10 of that group are here just to support what I'm doing. So in recent years, I haven't done it alone. And that, I think, is what I'd like to say to you. If whatever you're working for or against, don't do it alone. Get somebody to do it with you. I went to China to the International Women's Conference, and I noticed that women all around the world are thinking the way I'm thinking and the way that you're thinking. And having all those women there thinking about the rights of women together was so incredibly powerful, as having all of you here today is powerful. I'm also fortunate that I got married when I was very young. So I have my children, I have 6 of them, and I have grandchildren and great-grandchildren. And then I have my mom and my grandmother. So I have a firsthand knowledge of about 6 or 7 generations of women so that I can see how feminism has worked and the progress that has been made down through the years. And it's exciting. So when people say no progress has been made, I have to disagree with them. From the time my grandmother, who was the first generation free black woman, to my great-granddaughter, who will have opportunities that I never even dreamed were available. But then there's the fear that all of this can be taken away from us. And I think now that the information is at your fingertips, you know, the things that I had to wait for and fight for, the information I had to go and buy books to hear about or write on television, they're on the internet. But for cultures like mine who were taught that to write something down is dangerous and that there's proof of your activities and you can be punished, and also the freedoms that you're fighting for, those activities can be interrupted and stopped. So it's going to take a while for us to think that it's safe to put those ideas on paper or to send them out around the world on the internet. So you're going to have to be patient with us. You're going to have to notice that that's going on and that we as black women and many other cultures around the world have been taught to pass information orally. And it's like, these are my notes for today, and this is as much as I can write. So notice that, and give us a hand, and no criticism, please. And so these are my thoughts. It's like, don't do it alone. Know that progress has been made, and that more progress will be made. And as long as we hang in and work together, this world will be the kind of world that we want it to be, for women and everybody. Thank you.
My name is Sharon Bridgeforth, and I'm the writer and artistic director for the Root Women Theater Company, and I am also an HIV outreach specialist for Planned Parenthood's Project Reach. I never heard the word feminist growing up. I was raised by independent, freedom-seeking women that grew up in the segregated South, 12 in a shack, growing their own food, women that helped raise the neighborhood children, sold, ironed, and cleaned Miss Ann's house, cooked in the white-only country clubs, taught at the colored-only schools, and loved me fiercely. I never heard the word feminist growing up, and today I am angry, and I am hurt, because in preparing for this dialogue, I realized that the privilege of language, context, and understanding of what this society does to women stayed in the white-only sections of town. Therefore, I was denied the skills necessary to defend myself in certain degrading and heartbreaking situations. I think that feminism must meet the challenge of accessibility in the 90s. Racism, classism, elitism must be disembodied from the movement. Banji girls, round the way homegirls, cholas, unruly dykes, poor women, elder women, culturally traditional women and girls need to be invited to the table, given their props, listened to, heard, and taught. I think that feminists must organize educational programs much like the HIV/AIDS activists did, getting out in the community, standing on street corners, talking in churches and schools, first learning how to truly embrace and appreciate diverse populations. I didn't hear the word feminist growing up. I hope that the girl and boy children of the 90s don't have to say the same. Thank you.
My name is Lillian Stevens. I'm the coordinator of community outreach at the Esperanza Peace and Justice Center and the coordinator of the 1996 Other America Film Festival. When I think of feminism, it is a particularly painful word for me. My first experiences with the feminist element in San Antonio were initiated out of my need for activism and my sense of political isolation. The experiences themselves drove me back further into isolation than I had ever been before. The attempt on my part to find a place in the feminist movement was met with resistance by white women whose deeply entrenched fear of the color of my skin precluded my finding that space. Similarly, my first experience with black nationalism offered me a predefined space, subordinate to my African American brothers. I left and isolated myself again. White male supremacist ideology is like a cancer. It has metastasized itself into sexism, racism, classism, heterosexism, and other forms of oppression that each by itself can make our society ill, but the singular elimination of one cannot make us well. My first positive experience with feminism was in 1989. The organization was the Esperanza Peace and Justice Center in San Antonio, Texas. The Esperanza is a woman of color run feminist organization. It is also anti-racist, anti-ageist, anti-classist. We are an AIDS activist and a human rights activist organization that advocates for the rights of lesbians and gay men and provides a space for artists, environmentalists, animal rights advocacy, and anti-war activism. Our space is a meeting space, a resource center, and an art gallery. On any one day, you may walk into our space and see a young Latino gang member and a white 75-year-old feminist lesbian. It finally makes sense. The parts cannot be greater than the whole. Now, it is my responsibility as a member of an organization that it created an enormous table and set a place for everyone to ensure that no one is ever driven into isolation because there is no space for them. It is my responsibility as a woman who has walked away to not be complacent with the work we are doing, but to engage in critical dialogue and, yes, criticism, to not be the person who is always easy to get along with, but one who is demanding and demanding and demanding that unless we continue to ensure the inclusion of everyone, until we become proactive and devoutly engaged in eliminating white male supremacist ideology, our society is terminal. I cannot afford to be a feminist in the 90s without making the people I work with and those who would exclude me uncomfortable. I cannot afford to be a feminist in the 90s without being anti-racist and anti-classist, without being an AIDS activist and a human rights activist that is insistent upon the rights of lesbians and gay men, and an advocate for children and for elders and for the homeless. I must be an advocate for genuine equal protection under the law for people of color, and an advocate for protection of the environment that includes an end to environmental racism and gentrification. I cannot afford to be a feminist in the 90s without being all of these things, and I submit that neither can any of you.
Good afternoon. I am Mercedes Linda Uriarte, and I am a woman, obviously, a mother. I have a son and a daughter. I was a single head of household when I started college as a freshman, and by the time I left graduate school, we were all three in college. So I have experienced a number of class positions in my lifetime, and perhaps that leads me to, I am now a professor of journalism at the University of Texas and a practicing journalist also. And that perhaps my own personal experience may be why, although I consider myself a feminist, I do so privately. I appreciate what feminists have done to open access to women, but I've never been able to identify with their movement, in part because I've never found it to be a very welcoming movement. I think one of the key problems with the women's movement today, which gets lumped into the concept of feminism as sort of the only definition of it, is that as the media has moved to negatively label affirmative action, they have been basically quiet while affirmative action has been redefined in the media as something that only affects minorities. Nevertheless, white women, according to all studies made, have benefited more from affirmative action than have minority women. Indeed, in the academy, the position of minority women has not changed in 20 years. Although there are larger numbers of minority women now in the academy, there are far larger numbers of white women. So minority women haven't gained any ground. And the same is true in my other profession, in journalism. White women make up, for example, 50% of all the journalism academics in the country. But minorities, men and women together, only make up 5%. And if we look at Latinas, people teaching journalism in higher education today, there are 24 Latinos, men and women, nationwide. Six of those are women. Two of us are tenured. So while it is critical that we continue to fight for access, as that access gets labeled negatively, white women seem to be very quiet, and that's very hard to understand. But perhaps it speaks to the other problem I have with the women's movement, and that is the sort of absence of concern for nurture. It seems to me that family values, as they get defined in the women's movement, seem to concentrate on professional values rather than those values that many of us from other cultures consider to be every bit as important, if not more so, than the matter of earning as much money as a male counterpart. It is also the right to retain as close a connection as possible with your children. And one of the reasons you want to do that is because those of you who have children know the minute you put them in public school, the rest of their young lives you will battle with institutions to try to preserve some corner of socialization connected to your family. Uh, I fear that if we all jump on the bandwagon for having massive kinds of institutionalized childcare, beginning when this poor creature is 6 weeks old, we will lose all our rebels. We will lose our independent thinkers. Everyone will take nap time at the same time, and everyone will eat the same lunch. And if we are what we eat, that speaks to... I'm also concerned because the women's movement, which is defined as the feminist definition in this country, doesn't pay a lot of attention to class. And because they don't understand that for many of us, decent work for men is a feminist issue. It leads to stability in relationships, families. For work for our sons is as important to us as work for our daughters. And yet there doesn't seem to be a forum that allows us to talk about it as a feminist issue. So that's another one of my concerns. And another reason why I don't identify with the women's movement, though I do think of myself as a feminist. I guess the greatest concern I have speaks to some of the topics that others have raised, and that is the role of media in defining us for us. One of the problems that we have in this country today is the pell-mell race to corporatization of media. Some of the wealthiest, most powerful institutions in our country today, those with enormous global reach, like Time, Warner, Disney, for example, are in a position now to become, to define us for us, to deny us voice even more completely than they have in the past. We are facing an era, I fear, of corporate authoritarianism. And those of us who are used to thinking of this country as democratic and therefore free of having a controlled press, I think need to start thinking about press control in other terms rather than government control of press. If you look at the media, there's some very sobering statistics there as well. There are, for example, of all the people who work as journalists, only barely 10% are minorities, men and women. And when you break that down, 6% are black. And the reason that they are the largest percentage is largely because of black institutions, not because of white institutions. White journalism is white journalism. It's not inclusive, whether it's in the academy or in the newsroom. 3% barely are Latinos, 1% are Asian Americans, and 0.3% are American Indians. Those figures have been stagnant, those last three, for the last 5 years. Two years ago, 11 women editors were among the 1,700 daily newspapers in this country. In the last 2 years, in a growing push of force out, we are down now to 8. In fact, this city lost its woman editor in a force out move, and the women in this city did not do much about it. And yet, she had worked to bring more. That newsroom was 50% gender divided when she left, and had the highest minority participation rate of any mid-sized newspaper in the country. And that's part of the problem for her. We need to recognize the shapes that power takes and learn how to be feminist in nurturant ways and activist ways to protect that. Thank you.
My name is Andrea Beckham, and I'm a choreographer and dancer here in this community and the global community as well. I've been traveling a lot around the world, performing and teaching and learning a lot everywhere I go. I feel honored to be able to share some of that with you today. My personal viewpoint about art is that it should provoke and empower the audience, not just to have a response, but to perhaps go out and make their own art. I think there's art in everything we do every day, whether it's making bread or playing with your children or whatever. Being a performance artist, I try to take that to the stage in a way that gives a perspective that I wouldn't consider political, but really just making art as if the world matters. So I also don't really know what a feminist is. And one of the first pieces that I made was provoked by a quote by Rebecca West, and she said something, forgive me if I misquote a little bit, but she said something along the lines of, I don't know what a feminist is, but that's what they call me when I try to distinguish myself from a doormat or a prostitute. And I thought that was very powerful. The piece I made, Feminist Doormat, was also provoked. My background is in sociology. I was a sociology major. I had to dance. But I had read several different studies, and I took a lot of different women's studies courses. And one of those was a study by Shula Smith Firestone, her smile boycott, if anyone's familiar with that. And for the piece, I took a little bit of liberty with the three words feminist, feminine, and female. And it was a trio of three women, and I divided it into very clearly, after interviewing all of my friends and people on the street and et cetera, what were our perspectives on those three words? So I'm not going to interview you, but you could think about it. This is the kind of art that I enjoy seeing, something that has a lot of thought behind it, but there's also a lot of room for your own perspective in it. I think some of the challenges facing artists, particularly female artists, whether you're a poet or a painter or a pianist or a dancer, are to show a perspective that is uniquely female and give a little bit of the values and the issues and slip everything you can, be as subversive with your art as possible. Slip everything in there that you want to say in a way that people will listen. Some of the special challenges that I feel personally come from not feeling supported by other women, and that is a difficulty. I think the Foundation for Compassionate Society and this organization and this convention today is a very good example of what can happen when you are supported and when you believe in what the people around you are doing. You have the technical skills and the organizational skills and the ability to get something on this scale going. If you do have those kind of skills and you see someone next to you that needs your help, you should probably reach out and help them. A lot of what Anna Sisnet was talking about when she said she was techno mama, I have often been baffled by technology, and I get really angry with myself because that feels like such a cop-out. Oh, she's a girl, she doesn't need to know. And it is a cop-out, so I need to go learn. So, you know, I do along the way, and it's great when I can learn from another woman. I'd like to leave you with one thought today. My friend Sally Jacques and I were talking about sort of the place for art in the world, especially in the world of women. And I had read a little piece of Nelson Mandela's inaugural speech, and just want to pass it on today. He said, our greatest fear is not that we are inadequate. Our greatest fear is that we are powerful beyond measure. And it goes on to say, who are we to play small? So I'd just like to encourage each and every one of you to dream huge and then go out and do it. Thank you.
Speaking of love, you ask how much you should give, expect, and receive. Take what you could, give what you must, cause whatever's for us, for us. Whatever's for us, for us.
I watch for and what it should be. Do what you will, say what you must, cause whatever's for us. Speaking of life, you ask how right you are to be feared. Oh Lord, he's not alive, fear not to trust, cause whatever's for us, whatever's for us.
Whatever's bad.